Hello, I'm Lee McCallum from McCallum Goldsmiths. I want to apologise for not being here this morning. I was at the Careers Research Symposium, but from what I've seen, this is really great. So I'm here to present some work I've done with Rebecca Freebrink about supporting future engineering and using machine learning. And I updated my slides yesterday, but they used to be like, so it's really interesting. Okay, so first, so what we do when we talk about end-user machine learning is, although machine learning has proved to be super useful in coming up with solutions to problems that humans were unable to do, machine learning can also be super powerful for non-experts as a way to program things. For example, you take someone who's non-technical, who's an end user that receives a product, if they, rather than having to program something, what they can do is they can just provide examples of something, and then the machine will learn how to do it. So when we're talking about designing for these people and designing machine learning systems, we're talking about people who have no technical skills, perhaps no maths knowledge, no programming skills, but they would want to be able to use machine learning in some way to end up by customizing some behavior in either software or hardware. So, for example, so feature engineering is also a very important part of machine learning. You can get from something which doesn't really learn at all, and you have the right feature representation, I'm sure you're aware of this, and you can get something which doesn't work at all to something which can be quite a complicated solution. For example, if you're working with audio or if you're working with images, very rarely do you just use the raw data. So audio, you get maybe expected information, and people are starting to do stuff with large data sets and big deep networks where you would just put in the raw bits of data. But often in the end user situation where the users are providing the data themselves, you don't have that much data set. So really sometimes feature engineering is going to be necessary for them to get to the results that they want. Quite often also the kind of approaches we use in IML, you would want to rather than explicitly to capture data over time, you would use features to kind of aggregate your input data over time. So it can definitely be useful there as well. So there's some challenges that face. So if you take a non-expert already, people have already approached building systems for end use, building machine learning, just using GUIs. But quite often, these don't involve any feature engineering. They will just take the inputs straight in. So the challenge for the non-expert is in deciding what features they need to use. So they might need some like knowledge of using information retrieval, open computer vision. They might need some kind of DSP for clearing up the data, the ideas of mathematical functions such as a first order difference or a standard deviation or a limit variation. All of these things, if you're looking at just someone who's using a product, they don't really have an idea of how to do this. Also, even if they know what features they're looking for, getting the tool chain to actually be able to put that into their own learning system can also be challenging. So there are, like I said, sort of kind of GUI-based systems, such as the RAP method, that will allow people to just provide data to the model and then get something back without doing much kind of technical input themselves when programming. They give them to either abstract some features from sound or vision data, or maybe load in a pre-trained model. This is a feature extractor. They're going to have to engage with programming in some way. So what we're looking at is what's the best way to take something that's clearly advantageous, engineering with features, how can we fit this into the kind of end-user machine learning pipeline? first option you could look at is just not including them at all. Essentially, you just say, it's not the thing that's good for you, and the thing that makes you useful is that you're able to know your problem, you're able to provide data yourself, and to evaluate that, provide more data, train it on that, and actually involve you in the future kind of engineering step, isn't something you really need to be involved in. So some ways of doing that is by transfer learning, so you could take kind of a big existing data set and train on a lot of data and use that just as a feature extractor. Unfortunately, you need a lot of data to do that. And as I said, often in kind of end user situations, the data is user provided. So you've got quite small data sets. Also, if you were going to take something that had been trained on a big data set, for example, a teachable machine is a Google project where they use mobile net, which is trained on ImageNet, it's a feature extract at the beginning that allows people to acquire very small data sets to then train some image classifiers. So that works well if you're using images that are present in ImageNet, like cars or people or giraffes. But if you're looking at something that's maybe more abstract or astronomy data or medical imaging, something that's not present in the original data set, that doesn't really exist. So in order for transfer learning to kind of be applicable with it, you kind of need sets of big sets of data that solve similar problems already. Another approach is to define a superset of features that are available and then have some way of either searching them to find the best solution or filtering them. So you would either take some kind of filtering approach, taking some kind of metric such as information gain, ranking all the available features, and then just cutting everything to the threshold and saying, give me the top 5%. And you can also do rapid selection. So what this does is takes, again, the whole superset, and we'll do a kind of forward search to find and actually run your model, evaluate, and then use that as a kind of heuristic for driving a search algorithm. As you can imagine, even if you've not got that many possible features, the number of individual combinations of that feature set is massive. It's actually very computationally expensive. So again, it doesn't really fit into this kind of iterative workflow where the user's providing data, evaluating it, providing more data. You want something to be as close to real time as possible. So, if these automated methods may prove problematic, we decided to conduct a short study, one, to decide if we were going to try and introduce some feature engineering into this IML process, what's the best way to do it. Also, it will provide us with some good representative data sets where we can compare the results of automated methods against each other. And so we conducted a short study where we took 17 participants and got them to use the WECA native interface that most people commonly know what that is. Yeah, cool. So that's a GUI-based interface, and we gave them a phone and said we took the 6 inputs, so that's 3 axes in the solar between 3 axes in the gyroscope. Gave them 20 minutes to learn 5 gestures using a feature engineering interface we built onto WECA native. We got them to record a separate test set so we could do good comparative accuracy. We then had a short interview and also analyze the software logs. So I'll quickly show the new interface that we built and quickly go through it. So we picked around 200 features. Mainly mathematical transforms and aggregate data over the time, so things like standard deviation, FFTs, first degree difference, first and that kind of thing. We allow people to search through by category and pick new features. We also show people what sensor they were using, so if it was that lens accelerometer wide, so it shows them the direction that they're looking at, so if they want to try and relate that back to their gestures, they're able to do that. We also gave a semantic description of the mathematical functions and some kind of advice for how they might use that. So use standard deviation if you're interested in the variation of your gestures. We just gave a plot of the output and some evaluative tools. So this is a graph that shows how your gesture recognition is acting in real time. So some people are evaluating just through use rather than by using some metrics such as cross-validation. They can do that easily. The colours will show them kind of how things are classified and misclassified. Or they see them. And some other evaluative things as well. So we picked a number of feature sets to compare. We had the raw stuff, we had all of the available features we chose. We looked at the final feature, so the user's feature set, and then we then had two different feature sets based on thresholding and based on information gain. We also chose the had a feature set that was picked by wrapper selection. That's the wrapper selection used in the Wiki library. So the results, we found that using features was good. Almost always just the raw features performed pretty poorly. Also the sets that users picked performed really poorly. We found that using all the features performed quite well. It's worth noting this is not all possible features, this is just the finite set of features that we allow people to use. But kind of generally, you would have thought that getting people to reduce the size of their sets would be good, promote open fitting. But that didn't work out. We also found that the wrapper search performed worse than the threshold information gain sets. And we also found that the wrapper search took about 15 minutes to look, so it was really an infeasible method. It also actually didn't really provide us with very good sets. So I think the takeaway here is that we kind of came in with this assumption that we would want users to be discriminate in picking individuals, being quite detailed in the features they pick. However, it turned out these kind of quite larger and more indiscriminate methods actually turned out to provide us with better accuracies. Despite users not actually working that well, in fact, a lot of them actually thought they did quite well, which is kind of an interesting point. So whether that's to suggest that the metrics that we were using for accuracy to define how the system works, well, it's not the same thing that the users were doing, or whether they were just overconfident, it's an interesting point. We just found that direct evaluation was popular, so rather than necessarily looking at the cross-validation or confusion matrix, people would like to change the feature set, use it, look at the graph, see how it's working, and then add, change more features, use it again. We found that was very popular. Traditional metrics that maybe a data scientist use wasn't the ones that users were using. We also found that actually the number of features that they experimented with was very small. They tended to stick to just means and first order differences. I think maybe pushing people to try and decide on different ones, but maybe they didn't understand, they decided to just not use them. Thank you. Sorry, I ran out of time.
Well, now for maybe a couple of questions.
So I imagine that if you have like a stable domain like gesture recognition,
mm-hmm.
The feature set can be pretty fixed, which I guess is the conclusion here, or?
I guess it depends. We came up with 200 features just because we wanted to compare automated methods of that you need a finite set. And although we found a large set of 200 features work quite well, conceivably there is way, way, way more than that when you look at window sizes and that kind of thing. And even the ones that performed well, actually in the scheme of things, accuracies were still reasonably low, they were still in like 80%-ish. So I think there's probably more.
But the question I want to get to, would it be interesting to compare more different application domains? Because just intuitively, feature selection would be more important if you had really, really different tasks and you wanted to train something for.
So are you suggesting that, that there's a small range of gestures to be learned? I would argue that whilst there are some like common gestures, if you think of applications such as maybe more creative stuff, like stuff with a dancer, something more abstract, or maybe someone with a disability who has very kind of unique movement constraints, these are things which are not necessarily going to be catered for by kind of an out-of-the-box solution, even if the out-of-the-box solution is just a group of features.
I thought that you take gesture recognition, and then you take recognizing swimming pools in Google Maps. And then I imagine that the features you select are more important.
Sorry, but
we can take it later.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.